Good morning, beloved. All rise and sing with us hymn number 718, Come Ye Thankful People, Come. Beloved, you may be seated. Oh, that was our first processional hymn in 21 months. Yes. Sorry, I still have chills. We did it. Happy Thanksgiving. And welcome to the First Church in Sterling, where we are gathered in the spirit of Jesus, committed to creating heaven on earth. We are still practicing physical We are still spreading a pandemic of love, no longer practicing physical distancing. Welcome to all who need a church home and to all who call this church home already. Welcome to people from all towns and cities and states and countries. Welcome to all who want to follow Christ, who have doubts, who do not believe. Welcome to people of all ages, races, nationalities, abilities, sexualities, and gender expressions. Welcome to single, to partnered, and to married people. Welcome to believers, welcome to questioners, welcome to questioning believers, welcome to everyone! We welcome you to come as you are and to meet this God who challenges us to be more than we think we can be. We welcome you if you are not perfect, because certainly neither are we, and we know that the church at times has rejected difference and denied God's promise for itself and for others, which is why we say without reservation that you are welcome here just as God welcomes you as a beloved child. We are especially delighted to see you here if this is your first time with us, and especially also if this is your first time back with us in a very long time. And we would love to know more about you. You will find a welcome card in those plastic folders in your pews, along with information about our church, and you can take home the information and put the welcome cards that you have diligently filled out into our offertory plates during the offertory so that we can learn more about you and you can learn more about us. We would be so thankful if you did that. We also would love to invite you to come to coffee hour immediately following church. Yay! This is our first week of being allowed again by our operations team, who has been diligently keeping us safe for the last 21 months. And is now saying that eating inside is okay for us to do, so if we choose to. So we actually have an abundance of food for coffee hour in our parish hall. We would love for you to join us there. We cannot wait to connect with you there after church. All right, First Church has blended worship these days, which means that kids and adults worship together every week. And the joy, laughter, and presence of children brings an authenticity that reflects the diversity of beauty in our community. Isn't that right? So by welcoming children and by modeling to our members that children are to be celebrated and welcomed into worship, we live into the example of Jesus and his ministry, and we could not be more pleased to have our children with us at all times. Amen? So children and babies of all ages are always welcome here, and all ages are encouraged to worship together. We also provide safe and loving professional childcare during our worship time still in our Kinder Watch room. It is staffed by Clyde Hager and others, and we are so lucky to have them there. So if you would like a wiggle-free experience this morning, that is okay. Just see an usher, and they will help you find the Kinder Watch room. Children are also welcome to sit in the front rows of the sanctuary with Pastor Zach when he's not leading worship, and their peers and the teenagers that sit up there, if parents prefer to worship in the quiet of their own pews, or if kids prefer to worship with each other. We have Sunday school immediately following church, so we have spirit play for our youngest kids in preschool to first grade, kids club for kids in second to fifth grade, and donut church for our teenagers in sixth to 12th grades. And that happens immediately after church. So there are snacks for children in room two. Yes, you can eat them. And please bring your children. It's only about 45 minutes and ends when coffee hour ends. If you ordered Thanksgiving pies from our Pizza Church youth, don't forget to pick them up. Thanksgiving is this week. It's on Thursday. So you have to pick up your pies on Wednesday. It's at 3 o'clock. Is that right, Zach?
Between 1 and 3.
Between 1 and 3. So you can come between 1 and 3 to pick up your pies. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of Advent. I just wanted to say that. Isn't that crazy? Weird. All right. So Christmas is coming. Okay, a message from the Food is Love team. This is written by our Janet. Dear beloved, Operation Food is Love's conception was in response to a worldwide pandemic that thrust us into emergency survival mode. The world was dying around us. We became scared and vulnerable. We learned to give like never before, to be brave, to better understand what it means to give and to also receive, making us stronger together. The love expressed among us and within us was phenomenal. So many inspirational memories were made and new people welcomed into our lives. Operation Food is Love will forever remain in our minds and hearts. Together, we have proven that not only can we do hard things, we did do hard things, right? As the world begins to stabilize and open up, this one chapter of Food is Love, the Monday curbside dinner distribution, will cycle off with the last distribution on Monday, December 20th. Our recipients will receive fresh and frozen dinners, dried goods from what's left in the pantry, alternate food resource information, and contact information should they find themselves requiring future assistance. In addition, food gift certificates will be distributed, made possible by the proceeds received from the 5K Walk on the Wild Side event. As we move forward into a new year, we look forward to resuming the Food is Love Saturday Community Lunch on January 8th, 2022. Hooray! So I just want to ask Jennifer Scalise Mullett and everybody who worked on Food is Love to now please stand up so that we may recognize your incredible efforts in response to this tragic event in our world and the ways in which you brought our community together. Stand up, why aren't you standing? There are many opportunities for ministry and many events happening at First Church. Please see your bulletin and our email list for additional written announcements. And now we deepen into worship by saying together our affirmation of faith, which is printed in your bulletin. In the love of truth and the spirit of Jesus, we unite for the worship of God and the service of humankind.
We plow the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, the soft, refreshing rain.
We come to worship God. We recognize God as the source of all goodness. All good gifts come from the Spirit of God.
Love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, gentleness
are all of God. We come with grateful hearts, not for things, but for who God is. We gather to show our gratitude in song and in prayer.
Thank thee then, O Father, for all things bright and good. The seed time and the harvest, our life, our health, our food. No gifts have we to offer, for all thy love imparts. But that which thou desirest, our humble
my friends, you do not walk alone.
Thank you.
please, won't you pray with me? This morning, Lord, we want everything to be for your glory. We want our thoughts, our words, our songs, our church, our community, our resources, our time, our lives, all to be for you. Everything ours is yours. And we come together to declare this to be so on this holy day of Thanksgiving. Bless our time together with your holy presence. This we pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, beloved, may the peace of God be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Please turn and greet one another with signs of Christ's peace.
Hey, Sophia, can you say, hey, Jack and Brady, come on over here. There's two. There's Rumble, Rumble, I can help. And Thud. Good morning, church. This morning, we are going to be telling a story. But this is not your usual kind of story. What makes this story special is that I need your help to tell it. There are some words, three words, that you're going to hear a lot during the story. And for each of them, I need you to make a sound effect, okay? So everybody just go ahead and shake out all your shyness. Woo! Shake it out, shake it out. We got to do it, and we got to do it big, okay? All right, so here are the words I need you to listen for. The first word is hungry. So when you hear hungry, Jack is going to hold up. Rumble, rumble.
Rumble, rumble. And rumble. Then you're going to say
okay, so
rumble, rumble.
Go, rumble, rumble.
Rumble, rumble.
And then whenever someone, when I say stone, or Pastor Robin says stone, Brady, hold up. Thud, thud. Thud, thud.
And you're
so
gonna
you can
stop.
Use your feet. Thud, thud. Okay? And when you hear the word volunteer, you hold up, I can help. So say it with me. I can help. Okay, so we got, again, hungry. Rumble, rumble.
Rumble, rumble.
Stone. Thud, thud. Or volunteer. I can help. All right, here we're rocking and rolling. There are also special props in your pews that you may have already sat on. Apologies. We'll be needing those. Those are for soup. You'll be welcome to be a part of the story with those props. So make sure that you're paying attention because you might be required to bring one of those ingredients and plop it in a big old pot. So
That's adults, too.
Adults, too. Look around and see what ingredients you got. Thus begins our story of stone, thud, thud, soup.
A traveler reached a town late one afternoon. He had been walking for hours, and he was tired and very, very hungry.
Rumble, rumble.
I'm so hungry,
rumble, rumble,
he said, but I'm afraid I won't eat because I have no money and no food.
Tough luck.
No food and no money, what was he gonna do? And as he pondered his predicament, the traveler wandered into the middle of the town square. Soon, all the townspeople gathered around him. You're all gathered around him, townspeople, curious about this stranger. Hello, said the traveler. I've traveled very far, and I'm really tired and hungry.
Rumble, rumble.
Would it be okay if I camp here for the night?
Sure.
The awkward silence is because I was to have a line.
Yeah.
You can camp here, replied the mayor, but we can't feed you. We barely have enough for ourselves, let alone extra food to give to you. Oh well, said the disappointed traveler. Wait a second. I know. We can make stone soup.
Keep going.
The townspeople looked at the traveler. My thing keeps changing access radio, sorry. The townspeople looked at the traveler a little to the side. Stone
thud
soup. The townspeople looked at the traveler and said, stone soup, it would be fun to see how the traveler pulled this one off. Okay, I'll bite, said the blacksmith. How do you make stone soup?
Well, first we will need a large pot, explained the traveler. Someone named Sophia Falvalita and Hannah volunteered. Volunteered!
I can help!
And brought the largest pot that they could find. Great, said the traveler. Great, said the traveler. And now we need some water to fill it and fire to heat it. And carried a pitcher of water in a pew with nobody saying, oh, no, with Adam carried a pitcher of water to fill it. He volunteered.
I can help.
And carried many buckets of water in order to fill the pot. A fire was built on the village square and the pot began to boil. The traveler was very pleased. Then he asked, please, may I have 3 round, smooth stones? The townspeople's eyes grew round as they watched the traveler drop the 3 stones.
Plunk, plunk, thud, thud.
Into the pot. By now, everyone was hungry.
Rumble, rumble.
After a few minutes of watching the stone water boil, a townswoman volunteered.
I can help.
To add something to the soup. Well, any soup needs some salt and pepper.
Who's got salt and pepper?
Does anybody have salt and pepper? If you have salt and pepper, bring it forward. If not, we can pretend. Nobody has salt and pepper, okay.
Oh, no, please,
Max,
come on.
Oh, here they come. Oh, my goodness.
Thank
Yay. Oh, thank you, said the traveler. Stones like these generally make good soup. But, oh, if only we had some other things to add, it would be so much better. At that, someone else volunteered. It's not much, but I've got some leftover beans at home I could put into the soup.
All right.
And they went home and got his beans and threw it into the soup pot. And some green beans, too.
This is a beanie soup.
And oh, yes. This is going to be hard on the intestinal tract. Lots of beans. Another woman volunteered.
I can help.
To add her carrots to the pot. Oh, my goodness. And so many people brought carrots.
Yes.
So, oh, my goodness. So many people had carrots to bring.
Yes.
So many carrots.
Good job.
They volunteered so many carrots. I can help. And the blacksmith brought his or her potatoes, small potatoes and large potatoes and sweet potatoes, and lots of blacksmiths are in this community with potatoes. And the potter volunteered.
I can help.
And brought their celery. And there was celery, I think. Oh, it's coming. Oh, so much celery. They volunteered and brought their celery.
The soup is gonna be great.
And the cobbler volunteered and brought zucchini.
I can help.
Thank you for remembering your part. Brought zucchini, and someone volunteered and brought garlic.
I can help.
And some brought pumpkin, and and some brought Brussels sprouts, and some brought peppers, and some brought garlic, more garlic, and some brought the cans that they have for the Wachusett food pantry, and some brought whatever they have left in their pews that hasn't been called out yet. Parsley. Someone brought onions, and someone brought turnips and parsnips, and food pantry donations. They volunteered all of these things. And soon, rice. Oh, we needed a starch. Thank you.
We had potatoes.
We did have potatoes. We didn't need a starch at all.
Yeah, no. No, we had a lot of potatoes.
Soon, every townsperson had contributed, and the pot boiled with a hearty, thick soup enough for everyone to share. At last, the soup was ready. Everyone was so hungry.
Rumble, rumble.
Tables were set in the square. All around, torches were lit. Such a soup! How good it smelled. Everybody smell it.
Ooh.
Finally, everyone sat down to eat, having brought what little extras they had from home. Never had there been such a feast. Never had the townspeople tasted such a soup. And to think, made from a stone. They ate and drank, and they drank and they ate. They danced and sang far into the night. In the morning, the whole town gathered in the square to give the traveler a send-off. Oh, there he is. Many thanks for what you have taught us, said the mayor. We shall never go hungry.
Rumble, rumble.
Again. Now that we know how to work together and make stone soup, here ends our story. And give yourselves a round of applause.
Today's responsive reading is from the Psalms, Psalm 100, found on page 552 in your Old Testament, in your pew Bibles. A psalm of thanksgiving. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Reading from the Christian scriptures, Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Let the church hear what the Spirit is saying.
Grateful for each hand we hold, gathered round this table. From far and near we travel home, blessed that we are able. Grateful for this sheltered place, with light in every window. Sing, welcome, welcome, share this feast. Come in away from sorrow. Son, neighbor, friend, and friendless, all together, everyone, in the gift of loving kindness. Grateful for what's understood and all that is forgiven. We try so hard to be good, to lead a life worth living. Father, mother, daughter, son, hand we hold, gathered round this table.
Please, won't you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together find their way into the heart of God this morning. When Stan's neighbors move away, they give him a parrot, one who actually knows how to talk. But soon, it's clear that Stan's been tricked. The parrot is filthy, it smells, and it's noisy. Worst of all, the only words this parrot seems to know are obscene. Morning to night from the cage, all you hear is a torrent of obscenities, a hectoring storm of amoral bile that would make an old sailor blush. And then it gets worse. It's the night before Thanksgiving. Tomorrow, Stan's mother-in-law will arrive, and this is someone more proper than the Queen of England. She's always had her doubts about Stan. Somehow, he can't seem to ever say or do the right thing, and he had really wanted to make a good impression to put on a great Thanksgiving feast. All the shopping is done, all the plans are in place, they've done all the prep work, but now this awful parrot. So it's late and Stan is pacing. If this parrot had seemed offensive before, on Thanksgiving Eve, it is in rare form. Waxing eloquently about various anatomical parts, begins scatological riffs fit to boggle the mind, and Stan is beside himself. "Pipe down, you bad parrot," he cries. "Can't you hush?" But the parrot keeps squawking, and now it's worse. So Stan is really sweating it, and he doesn't know what to do. He pictures his mother-in-law at Thanksgiving with this loudmouthed bird spewing verbal garbage throughout, ruining the whole day, maybe even his whole life. It makes him want to weep. Be quiet, he wails, please. But the parrot gets louder, and if you can imagine, even more offensive. At last, Stan explodes. He reaches into the cage and he grabs the parrot by the neck and he runs into the kitchen and shoves the parrot into the freezer and then slams the door. And for a moment, you could hear the cursing continue, and then all at once, it just stops. Silence. And Stan suddenly is filled with remorse. He just wanted the parrot to be quiet, to stop cussing. He didn't mean to actually kill the poor thing. So he opens the freezer door, reaches in, pulls it out. The parrot is alive, shivering badly, and says, "Kind sir," he whimpers, "please allow me to offer my most sincere apology for my bad manner and my vile language. You will never, sir, hear the likes of that out of me ever again, ever," the parrot said. And Stan is amazed, he's speechless. And then the parrot goes on, "but just one more thing, kind sir, if I may. The turkey in there," the parrot nods at the freezer, "what on earth did he say?" What a beautiful thing to say after that gorgeous stance, right? That was good.
The tone,
right, yeah. We all know that it matters what we say. And it matters how we behave and what we do. And we go to great lengths to keep our words pure and honorable in our desire not to be the turkey, right? And last Thanksgiving, we might have skipped the grand affair because of the pandemic. So we may be a little rusty on how to people well this year. So this Thanksgiving, we will try our best to clean up our saltier language for our mother-in-laws, plaster on beautiful smiles even if our teeth are gritted, wear our best clothes with the elastic waistband, right? And be as polite and patient as we can with Uncle John, who can't stop talking about politics. So here's my advice for your Thanksgiving feasts. Breathe. Listen for understanding. Take breaks if you need to. Do your mindfulness practice. Pray for the person that you're having trouble loving. If the conversation gets heated, put on the new Adele album. Do you remember that 2016 Saturday Night Live skit when every time they started fighting about politics at the Thanksgiving table, they'd turn on Hello by Adele, Hello, and they would all, like, their hair would get all blustery, and everybody would stop fighting and, like, hold hands and sing Adele together. And she came out with a new single just in time. Go easy on me, baby. I was still a child. Zach's gonna sing the whole thing. We often think that our behavior alone can save us, that it is only our words, or more importantly, our actions that matter, right? But the Bible tells us that the thoughts inside our head are just as important as how we behave in public. Jesus says that we are to love God with all our hearts and with all our souls and with all our minds, right? And our neighbor as ourselves. We cannot love ourselves or our neighbors without fixing our minds on God. So, how do we do this? St. Paul says to the church of Philippi, finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. To some of us, this passage probably sounds like a nugget from a self-help book, right? Like, manifest the power of positive thinking. And the gospel of positive thinking that you can read about on the shelves of Target certainly comes from the great spiritual wisdom of the world's ancient faith traditions. But Paul is not at all exhorting Christians to change their minds so that we can ignore the bad stuff, help only ourselves, and live our best lives now. What Paul is talking about instead is disciplining our minds for the sake of each other and the church. He is talking about becoming one mind, centered only on love of God and love of neighbor. Paul knows that what lies between our ears is far more violent and dangerous a landscape than any street in the heart of downtown Worcester. And the cause of much of our suffering is where we are encountering our meanest critic in here, our doubts, our thought distortions, our contempt of self and others, our regrets about the past, our fears about the future. Our mind has the power to make whatever suffering we are currently encountering 1,000,000 times worse. We are what we think. That's why every great spiritual tradition has practices meant to train the mind, as Andy reminded us at Eat, Pray, Learn this past week. From contemplative prayer to mindfulness meditation, we are taught that the great spiritual journeys we embark on must begin in our heads before moving out into loving action in the world. So our work on earth is to learn how to use our mind as an instrument that is tuned to the values of God or Christ. We don't discipline our minds to be religious only for our sake, but for love's sake, for heaven's sake. So last week in the culmination of our From Pain to Possibility series, I preached Jesus' words that even in the midst of our deepest suffering, no one can take our joy from us. Remember that? Joy is the most vulnerable emotion, I said, of all emotions. So often we try to numb it quickly because we are so scared that we won't be able to keep it. Rejoice in the Lord always, Paul tells us. Again, I say rejoice, in case you didn't get it the first time, he says. Paul wrote this from prison in Ephesus, so he wasn't exactly living his best life now. Imagine what kind of mental training it took for St. Paul to experience joy from the filthy, underground, hot prison in which he likely endured daily torture. He must have had one heck of a gratitude practice, right? We know from research that the only difference between people who have a profound capacity for joy and those who don't, gratitude. Give thanks to God, Paul says, and the peace that surpasses all understandings will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Every time we experience a moment of bliss, especially in the depths of our suffering, every time we experience a moment of bliss, even from the depths of the prisons we find ourselves in, give thanks for it, Paul says. Feel your joy, even if it terrifies you. It is the path to peace. It is the beginning of the journey into the mind of God. The story about stone soup today is a story about what happens when you fix your mind on God. When you find you want nothing but what God in all grace has already given. When we put our minds to it, we believe in a God who creates this kind of abundance from scarcity, who can build soup from a rock. A God who says not enough is the best place to begin. A God who reminds us that none of this is ours. And the correct response when someone's tummy is rumbling is to say, what? I can help. A God who assures us peace beyond all understanding because we rejoice in what we have right here, right now. Beloved, love God with all your minds this Thanksgiving, not just your hearts. Pay attention and give thanks. At the very least, give thanks that you are not the turkey. Give thanks for abundance, every small win, every kind word, every grace. Allow yourselves to experience joy. It matters. Happy Thanksgiving, beloved. I love you. God loves you. God loves everyone else too. Amen. We will sing ourselves into a time of prayer now. You know this song. Just sing along when you get it. Courage, my friends, you do not walk alone. Won't you pray with me? God, like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have known your love and experienced your care and provision. You invite us to extend that love to the world around us, to care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And so we bring the needs of our world before you now. In your mercy, say with me, hear our prayer. We pray for the many who do not have enough food to eat or shelter to keep warm, enough employment or money to pay their bills, enough medicine or medical care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We also pray for those who have more than enough, but who still struggle to find meaning and purpose in life, who indulge in dangerous or self-serving activities to dull their pain or loneliness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, your grace reaches out to all of us. You call us to live as citizens of heaven, working together with one heart and mind. Strengthen us to live in a manner worthy of the good news we have received, offering our lives in service of your kingdom, where the last are first and the first are last, and there is enough grace for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the name of love we pray. Amen. Amen.
Friends, from time immemorial, food has been a way of giving thanks. And wherever human beings have gathered together, one of the tokens of a welcome reception and warm fellowship between friends and strangers alike has been sharing of bread. It's the very definition of the word communion, also companion. So today we gather together around our own Thanksgiving table, and we will share bread with one another. We will remind one another that we are made one in love. As we approach this holiday season, may the strength and nurturing of this congregation give us the courage to do hard things. But first, please put out your hands and point them at the bread that we have gathered at this table. And let's bless this bread. Gracious God, we come today grateful for our gifts. Bless this bread as a symbol of your abundance and symbol of the home we share. And as an act of thanksgiving, we desire to share your abundance, to give it away to others, so that we bless this bread, bread made by our pilgrim and indigenous ancestors with the fruit of their corn harvest, and made throughout the centuries to grace our Thanksgiving tables. Bless these people, your people, who share your gifts with the generosity of your spirit. With this humble bread offering, we ask that you unite us across difference. We ask that you unite us in our desire to feed and be fed, so that we might bless the world with your food and your love. Amen. Now this bread will be given and shared, and this morning's offering will be given and received.
Thanks be to thee, Lord, God of hosts, thou brought us forth with mighty hand.
God, thank you for all these gifts. Thank you especially for all these givers. We know that you haven't given yet. That's because the ushers got confused. They're coming around now, but it's really fine if you just leave your offering and the offering plate on the way out the door. That's totally fine too. That we were giving out so much that we forgot to ask for something too. Which is totally appropriate, actually. And while you're all standing, I want to pray our traditional Thanksgiving prayer that we pray every Sunday in this church, Thanksgiving Sunday in this church. I want to ask that if you feel comfortable to place a hand on a shoulder in front of you or beside you, as COVID safe as you can. We don't get COVID from surfaces, we know now, so... So be brave and touch each other if you want, and if not, that's okay too. Consent is the most important thing. And we pray these words in the words of Robert Louis Stevenson that we pray every year on this blessed, blessed day that is so much more blessed this year because we're all together. Lord, behold our family here assembled. We thank thee for this place in which we dwell, for the love that unites us, for the peace accorded to us this day, for the hope with which we expect the morrow, for the health, the work, the food, and the bright skies that make our lives delightful, and for our friends in all parts of the earth. Let peace abound in our small company. Purge out every heart the lurking grudge. Give us grace and strength to forbear and to persevere. Give us the grace to accept and forgive offenders. Forgetful ourselves, help us to bear cheerfully the forgetfulness of others. Give us courage and gaiety and the quiet mind. Spare to us our friends, soften to us our enemies. Bless us if it may be in all our innocent endeavors, if it may not give us the strength to encounter that which is to come, that we may be brave in peril, constant in tribulation, temperate in wrath, and in all changes of fortune and down to the gates of death, loyal and loving to one another. Amen. Amen. And now please join us in our final hymn, number 715, Now Thank We All Our God. Maybe in this there is a glimpse of the kingdom, a foretaste, a hint, a promise.
Let it hold you and let it send you, so you will never be at peace until all are fed.
Until all know home.
Until all are free.
Until justice is done.
Until peace is the way.
Until grace is the law.
Until love is the rule.
Until God's realm comes.
Until God's realm comes.
Until God's realm comes. Amen.